Yes, so I'm going to have a hard time here. Yeah, I'm Thomas. I run a software consultancy located in Germany. Yeah, and I want to talk today about API versioning. First, we will have a look at RESTful APIs, and then we have a look at all the other REST APIs that are not so RESTful. Yeah, and we will have a look what JSON and Swagger can provide for us. Yeah, let's start with the RESTful APIs. So REST, representational state transfer, is all about state and transitions from one state to the next state. I have here a state from a client. A client requested a resource or sent a request to a resource and got a representation and is now on that state. And using a link, it can transition from one state to the next state. Oops.
Is it plugged properly?
So. Don't move. Okay. Okay, so it moves from one state to the next state by transitioning and following a link. But the important thing is not the link, the important thing is the format. So the link can be anything, it can be different, it can even be something like that, and it's working. So the contract is the representation and not the link or the method. So the URIs are not part of the contract. You should, in REST, provide everything you need in the representations so you can interpret that and do the appropriate thing. So for RESTful APIs, you do not need versioning, or you do not need to think about versioning. Yeah, but who uses hypermedia? Just give me a sign who uses hypermedia for your APIs. Okay. And who uses it on the client? Because you have to use it on the client to get those benefits. I think almost nobody. I haven't seen any talk about hypermedia in this conference. Usually.
Yes, unfortunately, all the people have been last weekend in RESTfest in Poland.
Okay. So nobody talks about hypermedia anymore. And so we have real APIs, not RESTful APIs, and now we have to think a little bit more about versioning. Okay, so let's start with a URI and some version numbers in it. Yeah, I can see some look very critical. That's not a good idea what I have done here, because I have a bug fix ID in the URL, and if you use that for your APIs and you change the bug fix version, you will break the interface. And that's the reason why you use for version numbers usually just the major number in API versioning. Using the version number in path is a clever idea, because now you can use the version 1 and then you can write deploy a new version, and old clients can still reach the old version, new clients can access the new version. Yeah, but it was like that with the service-oriented architecture with web services, and then you get into version hell because you have to provide all those versions and run them. And yeah, we want to do that a little bit smarter, and so we try to use different client versions with the same server version, or the same namespace, the same URI, and to evolve the interface so it's still compatible even if you have changed something. Yeah, but how do you know when you break the interface? Every time you break the interface, you increase the version number. But as long as you do not break the interface, you can keep it. So with REST, yeah, when I compare REST to gRPC, I discover that REST it looks very simple. So the first time you look at REST, you think, oh, that's really simple. You can use a web browser to get something, and it's not so complicated than formerly the web services. But in reality, REST is very, very technical, and a lot of things can change. And in REST API, all those things can change. So let's just have a look at some of them. What about a new endpoint? Does that break the interface? Just give me a sign, please, if you think it's breaking the interface. One guy is thinking it's breaking the interface.
Not breaking.
Okay, let's see. Yeah, it's usually not breaking the interface because usually you deploy new versions on the server side and the clients have older versions. But if you do contract first, for example, you design a Swagger document and you distribute it to different teams, and the client version 2 is developed before the server or deployed before the server, then it can happen that the client tries to call that path and that will fail with a 404. So usually you are right, it doesn't break, but just because on the server side things are deployed usually first. If you do not that way, you will break the interface. And so you get a pattern for a lot of things from the protocol, like the paths or the methods or even the status codes, that it depends where you deploy new versions first. And you can see that with two columns. Usually you deploy on the server the new version first, but if you do it otherwise, then it's different. And as you can see, additional paths, additional methods, or the removal of paths are just reversed depending where you deploy your stuff first. And besides deleting and adding, you can also rename paths or use a different method. So instead of put, you use a post, for example. But that's for a computer very difficult to grasp or to see automatically, and usually you will detect that as two things: a removal of a new method post, or an addition of a new method post, and a removal of an old method put. What about adding new fields? That's the same. If you add a new field, you usually have a default on server side and you can support new fields, but when you give back that field to the client side, it depends if the client validates that field or wants to see that field, and that depends on the client implementation. So if you have an API and lots of users and you're not even sure if you add a field to a document, if this breaks the interface because you do not know what toolkits are there around. And here it also depends in what direction you are sending the message with the new field. If you're sending it from the new version to the old version or from the old version to the new version. Yeah, let's have a quick look at query parameters. Query parameters, yeah, they are quite tolerant, so you can change the sequence. They are all optional, and additional query parameters are just ignored. Yeah, no talk without cats or dogs, so that's my chance here to have a dog slide. And suppose you have an interface giving back a 200 status code when you create a new resource. And now you want to make that a little bit more compatible or conform to the HTTP specification, and you want to return a 201 instead of a 200. Is this breaking the interface?
Depends on the client.
Yeah, exactly. That depends on the client. And unfortunately, if you have a public API and a lot of clients are connecting, somebody will make it like that. Somebody will have just a hard-coded 200 instead of testing a range, and say, okay, 201 or 204 is also okay, or 202 maybe it's not so okay, it depends. Okay, what else can we change? What about type changes? So we had a type string in a parameter, and now we are changing that to integer. Yeah, that's very hard to say. Usually you can think that's breaking the interface, but it's not always the case, because you are transmitting strings and then they are cast or converted to numbers. And if all the strings were numbers, actually it will work, but you are not quite sure. And so you have to think what is more specific from the data types when you exchange one data type against a second. Yeah, let's continue with JSON versioning. Most of the APIs now use JSON as a data format, and so we will have a look what JSON provides. So the first question, what do you change more often? The endpoints or the payload format? So when you think about API versioning, you think about paths, about methods and status codes, but actually more often you change the format, the data, and you have to stay compatible there. So a slide from the past. With XML, we know we do a, yeah, we like to bash XML, and JSON is better. And JSON is at one point much better than XML. It's not about just the message size, but for versioning, XML was very worse. You can do it the right way now, you have the knowledge, but years ago, when they did the service-oriented architecture, they used sequences for XML, and they had also a strange thing like the UPA constraint that made it hard to make interoperable XSD schemas. And so if you just change one field, you usually broke the interface. If you just add one field, you broke the interface back then, because parsers were not tolerable. If you just add a field, they say, okay, what should I do with the field? I have no idea, let's throw an error. And JSON is here different. It's not in a JSON specification, it's just the way we usually parse JSON. In JSON, there is no sequence. Okay, that's a hard thing. But then how do you read that out? Usually it's just picked and mapped to a class, and an object is built from that JSON. Or even you read it out more dynamically and just cherry pick the fields. And that's very, very tolerant against additional fields. So they are just ignored. Yeah, what about missing fields? Missing fields, you have usually defaults, and so you have pretty good features, not so good features than protocol buffer with the version numbers, or not version numbers, the IDs for the fields, because there you can just rename a field, what's not possible in JSON without using some other mechanisms or some formats like AFRO or protocol buffer. Yeah, but you have to be sure that you're not too strict. There are some frameworks out there that use these XML principles even for JSON, and if you use that annotation for Java code, you will get REST clients or REST resources. They are not immune against additional fields. Yeah, so JSON has some limitations. You have seen that in the gRPC talk, but other from that, it's a format that supports you much better than XML for versioning. Yeah, because the data, the file format, your JSON is changing more quickly then the endpoints, it might be a good idea to provide information about the schema you are using either inside the JSON. I like it inside, because if you provide that just additional field, it's ignored anyway, you make sure how the JSON message was constructed. And it is inside the message. So if you take the message without the context, if you take it out, you still know what schema was used. You can also provide the schema version with an attribute in the content type. And you can also say it's not just JSON, it's my JSON, or it's a vendor-specific JSON. But again, you have to be careful. If you do not do that from the start and you change the content type, that might break the interface. Okay. Let's continue with Swagger versioning. If you have a look inside Swagger, you will discover that inside Swagger documents there is a version number, and the version number has the components major, minor, and bug fix. So we have heard that you usually do not use bug fix versions inside the interface, but this version is not in the path, so you can use that, and you can increment in Swagger the bug fix number if you correct a spelling or something like that, and express that you changed something, and that's fine for Swagger. So it's a good idea to have here that three parts of the ID. Yeah, we got recently Swagger version 3, and Swagger 2 did not support hypermedia, and with Swagger 3 we got linking. Is somebody from Smart Beer here by chance? Okay. Yeah, with the new Swagger version or Open API, I'm still not used to say Open API to Swagger, but I think that's getting better. Okay, so there you have links. Okay. Are we finally getting hypermedia? Not quite. Because that's complicated and that's stuff for our own talk, but very quickly here what you get with Swagger version 3. With Swagger version 3 you got that linking feature, and it basically works like that. You get back the representation of a call, and then you have the Swagger description. And with the Swagger description and the representation, you can take out values from here and apply them against the template, and the result is a link or a collection of links that you can follow. Wow, cool. Finally we get hypermedia. No, that's not hypermedia. You have links, and it is indeed cool, but there's a difference to REST. With REST, the hyperlinks are computed by the server, and the server can give you just anything. Here, the server has nothing to do with the links. The links are described in Swagger and then computed on the client side. Yeah, but Swagger has some interesting features you can use for versioning. A Swagger document is a tree. And yeah, you can just compare trees and have a look what has changed, and using an algorithm based on that tree comparison, you can discover the changes between two versions, not just a diff on a text file level, but on a semantical level. And you can also apply context knowledge, so you know if you change something, if this is breaking the interface. There are some tools out there to compare different Swagger versions of the same interface. For example, Smart Beer has that Swagger Hub, and here you can see two versions of an interface, and it will show you the differences. Here, for example, there is a spelling, I think, in the summary, and here type changed to integer. that's pretty good, but you do not know where this is used, if it's in the definition. Here it is in a parameter, okay? Then you know for that endpoint, categories get, a parameter has changed. But what if you have a type changed in the definitions? Then you see that, but you do not know where that type was used. Yeah, there are more tools out there. For example, that Swagger diff tool here on GitHub, or I like that one, that Swagger diff. It creates for you a Markdown documentation with the changes. That's also pretty handy. If you introduce a new API version, you run that tool in 5 minutes, and you have a cool report that looks like you spent the half week creating that report. So it saves you a lot of time. Yeah, and that tool will also discover if you change something in JSON, like you delete a property, and it will discover that. Yeah, I had some time on the airport and also yesterday, so I thought, why not, that's just JSON, why not write a small tool myself for comparing Swagger? And I will just show what you can do with a couple of lines of JavaScript and two Swagger files. So if I run the comparison about these two versions, there is no change. And then I can change something. Here, for example, I can change the customer property first name. Let's make first name an integer. And then I run the tool. So I get back a report. And I have just changed one field, but you can see there are many changes now in the document. For example, it was used here in a response. And in the response, it says, okay, this will likely break the interface because it's more specific. Then you see here in an endpoint with put, it's changed also in, yeah, it's everywhere likely. I have to change something else that you see it's not likely. We can do that at the moment. Here you can see that's also changing and it's affecting lots of endpoints. Okay. Let's change a different thing. Instead of the integer, I take out a required field and run that. And then you can see here in the report that it's breaking in the response, but it's not breaking in the request. So there are some tools out there. If you're interested in that, it's about 200 lines of JavaScript. I will put that on GitHub too. Yeah, and with that in mind and with the APIs, I hope you can keep your interfaces. You can stay with them a long time instead of breaking them. Yeah, thanks for having me.